I think it's a real privilege to be invited to come and speak today. I've sat where you're sitting, and I think my career over many years now has given me quite an interesting perspective on junior athlete development. None of my ideas are unique to me. I've borrowed them from many, many people during the whole course of my career, and I've been inspired by people from within my own sport, such as Liz Chekovich, who's in the crowd today, who also works for Gymnastics Australia, and external to our sport, other coaches, international people. Many people have shaped my ideas that are now shaping the talent ID and high performance development at Gymnastics Australia. There's theory behind it all, and I think at Pathways, in the area of Pathways, we're thinking about capacity and capability. So it's all about the coaches, actually. It's all about developing coaches' skills so that they can mentor and create these athletes that we know they can be, because we've talent ID'd them from a very young age. I think since AWE came in 2012, the face of talent development has changed. I've been working for GAs for 5 or 6 years now, but only been in this role for 2 years, and we've come a long way in our recognition. Never before has talent development pathways been a really recognised career, really. It fits very nicely alongside your high performance manager, and the way I look at it is that the high performance director or manager is managing the whole pathway of your high performance development, whereas the pathways manager is more involved with talent ID, the development of that talent to a point where they're internationally competitive. And the point at which they have developed nicely and they're handed off to the national coach, this is my product for you, that's how I consider my job, then that becomes the national coach's role from that point forward. We use the F10 model a lot, and it's probably the first time that I have really embraced a model such as this, produced by the AIS, because I really see its application. And what it does is levels all sports together. So my job in Pathways, you saw the age group that I'm working with, you know, from 6 to 15, it's because we're senior athletes by 16. So when I look at a T2 athlete, a T3 athlete, a T4 athlete, I'm doing the same things you are with your T3. You might be rowing pathways manager, and you're working with your 18 and 19 year old boys at T3. I'm gymnastics pathway manager, and I'm working with my 12 and 13 year old girls at T3, but we're doing the same job. We're 3 or 4 years off benchmark performance, and we've got to fast track and prepare that athlete for the demands that are going to be placed upon them when the time comes. So it's not unusual, it's not spooky, it's not weird, it's not child abuse. It is what the sport requires to be competitive at the years that the sport is competed in. And for women's gymnastics, that's anything over 16. Men's gymnastics is similar age, but generally men develop a little bit later. So we target our 18, 19, 20 and beyond boys. Trampolining is a little bit more like men's gymnastics, and rhythmics a little bit more like women's gymnastics, a little bit younger. So let's just have a look at that. And I'd like to just step you through it from a Gymnastics Australia perspective, what we see in each level. It might be different to how you've interpreted the model, but this is how we see it. So this very bottom level, the foundation, that's our non-Gymnastics Australia gymnastics providers. And there's many of them that actually have nothing to do with Gymnastics Australia, but they're out there in the marketplace selling gymnastics. So it's Bounce. Has everyone heard of Bounce Trampolini? Nothing to do with gymnastics, but you walk through the door and they've got Olympic Trampolini playing on their video. Nothing to do with us. You've got like Gymbaroo, which is baby gym, basically from very early age right through to your kindy age. that doesn't have anything to do with Gymnastics Australia either. We've also got social aspects of our sport, such as parkour, you know, where they run down the street and salto off a wall and keep running, that kind of thing. Our job, not my job, because I'm up here in the talent area, but our job with our foundation staff at Gymnastics Australia is to try and create pathways from community sport involvement into gymnastics clubs. So there's a person dedicated to try and foster those relationships within Gymnastics Australia. Then you've got this part, which is probably, I'd say 90% of Gymnastics Australia membership fit in active lifestyle, your once a weekers. Gymnastics Australia has 165,000 members. And so if 90% of them sit in here, coming to gymnastics once a week is really important to us. And again, there's staff members dedicated to make sure those programs that support social gymnastics are very good. This one, foundation, we call that our social sport level. It's highly competitive. It's like your levels 1 to 10. Kids can do competitions, they can even go to nationals, they might go overseas and do a nice friendly competition overseas. They sit in this social sport level here. But what is important is the intent. The intent for someone who's sitting in this pathway isn't to reach the Olympic Games. Their intent is to enjoy their sport, compete, make friends, be the best gymnast they can be, but for whatever reason, they haven't joined the talent pathway and they're sitting out here enjoying their sport. So our job in the high performance area of gymnastics is this section. And it's governed by this mastery. We are all on the road to trying to produce mastery. That's everything that comes before is about mastery. Every time we choose a child with a TID, can this athlete, we look in our crystal ball and look at that little body and go, could I see that developing into something I can do something with? Yes, I can, I think I can. They come in quite talent demonstration. We get talent from all sorts of places. It can come from off the street over here. It can come from Bounce or Gymboroo or wherever over here. Or it can come from social gymnastics of any level. Come into a bona fide TID program. Why, you might say, why are those kids picked so early? Basically, because the demands of gymnastics are so great to get it right, that if errors are made out here, it's very difficult to fix them or change them as you go along the pathway. Your core base technique is really important. So actually, the coaches who are working down here in this T1 to T2 level are the ones we're most trying to influence. T2, we look at that as what's happening in our states. So your SSO-driven activities and your club-driven activities. So they might be getting a few clubs who are working in high-performance development, getting them together and running some camps, state camps, kids are training in their club and coming into a centre such as WACE to do some camps. They might be in their club for a period of time if the coach is capable, and then move across to a high-performance training centre at a later date. So fostering those relationships, building the capability of those coaches is really important to having a strong base of our system. Not everyone can train in your WACEs or your Melbourne NCE, your premier locations. So we need to be wider, spread our tentacles wider than that, and that is making sure that when kids are in the clubs at the lower level, that they are well looked after. T3 is where I spend the lion's share of my work. And I have a coordinator, Alexis Levedoux, who works closely with me, and we spend a lot of time in that area. And that's where our Team Future project sits, and I'll describe that in more detail in a moment. Breakthrough Award T4 is where pathways and national coaches meet. It's where the individual athlete plans are really important. So their base skills have been established, but what are they really, really good at? What can we capitalise? What do we need to drop because we're just never going to fix it? How do we position that athlete to grow and become the international athlete that they're capable of? That's what happens at the T4 level. We all know what elite representation is, and that is getting into the Australian team at a benchmark event. And those are, of course, Olympic Games, World Championships, and to a degree, Commonwealth Games for gymnastics. We've had lots of E1s over the years. Everybody does. Everybody's got to put a team forward and go to the event. The difference with this model is the E2, and that's success. How many of those athletes did we put on the podium? And for gymnastics, that's really difficult. It's a world game. It's like soccer. It's played everywhere in the world. It's heavily European, heavily Asian, not particularly Australian. So we're up against it with cultural differences and such high competition from all of us, all those countries around us. It's really tough gig. It's not Commonwealth countries only. You know, it's not a small pool. It would be one of the biggest sports in the world, I would think. Not that I know, but we get, you know, 50 to 60 countries coming to World Championships. That's a lot. And of course, mastery is producing that medal, that elusive medal, over subsequent Olympic cycles. And we've only ever had two in gymnastics, and they were men, and back probably 5 to 10 years ago now. We've only ever won one Olympic gymnastics medal, and that was in 2000 by a trampolinist. So medals and rewards are few and far between in this sport, but we are working really hard on our system to try and be competitive with the big countries of the world. We're not China. We can't start with 100,000 and whittle our way to a few. We have to start with a small pool and treat them really well, put them through the processes that we know will create the techniques, the mental skills, you know, the physical conditioning that's required, and, you know, hopefully create the champion that we would like. So that's how we see FTEM from a gymnastics point of view. And everything we do, we relate back to that. So what are we doing at T2? How are we helping the states provide their resources at T2? What are the T3 activities? What are the T4 initiatives? So that we're getting the athletes at every step of the pathway. So just in a brief overview, define gym sport pathways. So as I was saying, on our website, we have this little button called Are You Australia's Next Champion? So on the website, the pathways, we have all of these interesting things. And we acknowledge who are the clubs around the country who are working within our system. Who's working at T2 and T3? They're on the website. People can get on, go there, contact the right person to get their child into gymnastics. And so it goes on for the other gym sports. Your name is on the list if you're jumping through the hoops that Gymnastics Australia has asked you to. Though not every club wants to do that though. So then you could be a pathways club. And that's clubs who willingly supply talent to the Team Future clubs or the high performance training centres. Willingly let people through their doors, scouts, to look through their very young children in the classes and say, you know, that kid there has something I'd really like to explore talent-wise. Let's bring her in for a little trial, that type of thing. So clubs are acknowledged for their position in the pathway, which across the board hasn't been done very well in the past, and it's been really well embraced. What's the journey? It's another initiative of pathways. What does it look like? What can a parent expect to find each step of the journey? So we call this a Pathways Handbook, and it's in construction at the moment, and it tackles things like this, like when the child is 12 to 15, what are the constraints, what are the demands, what could that journey look like? So to be forewarned is a good thing. What mental attributes do they have at that stage? What physical attributes? So describing our population is important to us. Using good role models. I haven't started it yet, but it, an idea in my mind where I'd like to take it is called Blueprint of a Champion. And interview our champions, like the men who have become master athletes, Lauren Mitchell, and say, what were the key moments in your life where you didn't turn right, you turned left? I stepped forward and I took that moment, I took that chance to stay in gymnastics and go this way. Then the door opened, I stepped this way. What were those key moments? What was the family support like? It's a well-known fact that many high-achieving people have a serious, terrible thing that's happened in their life. They've had a death of a parent or a troubled childhood. What gives children the motivation to try and be a high-performing athlete? I think that's really fascinating, and that's a project for our future, is to use our champions that have come before as a bit of a template in how we could mentor our young champions, our developing champions, better. So these are interesting projects that I'm not going through in any more detail today, since we're doing something else. Right. Across our four gym sports, we have what's called a curriculum, and we call it the ideal skills. So for many sports, I would challenge for every sport, you need a technical curriculum. It's not a chance event that someone can actually do the skill you want them to do. It's built. So we have these curriculums. And they exist across all of our gym sports now. So I'll just show one in a bit more detail. So this is the women's gymnastics one. So it divides an apparatus into the key movements. It documents for age what we think would be a good standard timing to learn those skills. And it gives the coach a little bit of a recipe, I guess, of what to do in which order. And this is a key part of our Team Future program, which I'll show you later how we monitor this, because it's actually in the monitoring and getting coaches to adhere to it that is the difficult bit. You can have all the right ideas, but if coaches go, oh yeah, and go off on their own tangent anyway, it's a tough gig. This is influencing without authority. I can have all the great ideas in the world that I like, but if the person down there in Clubland doesn't want to do it, that's a real problem for me. So I have to find motivation, reason for that coach to jump through the hoops that I'm putting in front of them. So I'll describe that in more detail. So it's learning the right thing at the right time. That's the key. The step beyond that is individual athlete plans. So as I said, when that base is established, their ideal skills, their curriculum is strong, how do we then capitalise on the next step? So we have quite a complex spreadsheet for all of our targeted high-performing athletes, which we would have 20 or so seniors and another 30 or so girls underneath that who are on this in women's gymnastics. And women's gymnastics is leading in this area. We're a little slow on the uptake in this area in our other gym sports, but we'll get there. And I think I'll just quickly step through this, because again, this isn't the emphasis of today's discussion, but could be a whole other discussion, is how do you plan individually for an athlete? And we ummed and ahed over this for a number of years. What is the right template? How do you use it? And I guess it's, some key questions, what can the athlete do right now? What could they step out and what are their abilities right now? Where do you want to take them in 6 months, which is this one here. That's in 6 months' time. She wants to be there. If you move across, you get your crystal ball out and work out, well, where does she want to be in her benchmark year? So in 3 to 4 years' time, where would I like her to be? What skills, what competencies, how are we going to gel that together for 3 or 4 years' time? And then working back through the learning journey. So for each year up to her benchmark performance, which we're hoping is going to come in 2018, what does she have to learn when? How is that routine, the set of skills, going to come together at the right time, on the right day, properly? It's not just luck. It's well planned, it's documented on paper, and it's monitored. For a long time, we've let the coaches, it's in their head. And a lot of very experienced coaches operate in that manner. It's in their head. And we can no longer work like that. From the message from above down is that we have to be accountable. We have to show concrete evidence. Why would we fund and back this kid over that kid? What is our crystal ball telling us? And how we're doing it in gymnastics is in this kind of manner. Having regular meetings with the coaches. So this coach who coaches this athlete, it's not me, it's a personal coach. We meet and we talk about, well, how are you going? Are you competing that skill? Are you learning that skill? You said you would. Tell me how it's going. Those sorts of conversations have begun. So this is like a conversation starter. As much as a record, it keeps... we're responsible for the result at Gymnastics Australia. It's our sport, our result. But I don't employ those coaches. We need to come together and meet to decide which athletes and what they will have so that the national coach can inherit them when the time comes. So it's a really tricky business, but an integral part of success comes from this sort of planning. So I won't go through that any further, but it's a very interesting area. Let's move on. Ooh. Let's go backwards. Okay, this is the most important area for today. And it's our Team Future program, which is the T3 level of our FTEM model. So for your sport, think to yourself what a T3 athlete is. They're the ones doing the majority of the training. They're on high load training. It's highly expensive. They are dedicated to the cause. They're showing everything they're supposed to show, but they're still in underage competition. They're champions in waiting, this group of people. We supply the competition framework for these athletes. And you may ask, hey, well, what's the difference between the competition framework and the curriculum? How do you get your head around that? Because aren't they the same thing? And my challenge is that they're not at all the same thing. So I'll just do a demonstration here. And it'll be gymnastic-y, but I'd like you to think for your sport what the ultimate skills are. So for tennis, it might be serving at 140 kilometres an hour into the left-hand corner. I don't know how it's described. That the athlete can actually do exactly what you want them to do, and it requires a high level of skill, and it's part of the game at the highest level. For me, I'm going to take a skill which I know is in a podium floor routine, and I'll just write that in our gymnastics shorthand. So it's a double twisting, double back. There's a family of skills that sit underneath that skill. You don't pick that. You don't just step out and do a double twisting, double back. It came from somewhere. It came from its root family of skill. So it came from over here, you had to have a full twisting double back. You better have one of them, or you can't do one of them. You better have a double back. You better have a layout. I can't do get off the ground and do that if I can't do that. You better have a back tuck. You better have this skill on the trampoline. And you better have all of those skills that came before it on the trampoline, because that's where we can do a lot of repetition to be able to master this skill. You better have a cartwheel, a roundup, a backflip, a handstand, be able to jump at my physical capacity. Do I have the ankle flexibility? Do I have the wrist flexibility? Do I have the middle body control, etc., etc.? And that's one skill in one routine on one apparatus. So for this, international gymnast has 10 to 15 skills in every routine. This family tree of skills is curriculum. And that's what we're measuring, is curriculum. Competition framework sits in here like this. It's like a taster. It's like an exam. It is not the curriculum. It's just on the day you were asked to do X this many times and we judged you. It is not the whole picture. The whole picture is all of this work. And this is what I'm interested in. If athletes are only doing this work, and they're doing it to death, to death, to death, to death, to death, to death, because they want to win, it doesn't interest me. Oh, good, you won. Fantastic. Can you do anything else? No. Like asking a young, I don't know, I'm speaking out of my depth, but I'm pretending, like a soccer player to only play X position as a developing 10-year-old. Surely that's not what it's going to take to be an international player. They must have to have a lot more competencies than that one role at the one tournament has taken. So we're trying to monitor all of these attributes that we know lead to these skills. Because if we only do this, we're not going to get that. It's impossible. You don't have enough skill base, physical base, to underpin a high skill development. So this are those tables I showed you, the pretty pink table, the pretty purple table. That is this. This is another book, and a little book textbook that shows all the routines that the kids will do at a competition on the exam. This is limited by a number of factors. A club or program's ability to provide that is limited highly by technical. Can the coach all this? Do they have the capacity, capability to coach all these skills? It's limited by time. This takes a long time, and this is why gymnasts train 30 hours a week. They're not superwoman. We can't cut their training back to 15 hours a week and expect to learn all that. It's actually dangerous. And we cannot fit in everything we need to do to prepare an athlete for top level. Because we've got so much to learn in a period of time. And our biggest window is before adolescence, because we're a highly weight-supported sport. It's not that we want to keep them young and thin and agile from an aesthetic perspective. It's from a biomechanical perspective. For that athlete to be able to lift that body, perform those rotations, have the right moment of inertia, the right power-strength ratio, this happens before adolescence. Then it's hold on for the rough ride through adolescence and beyond. And those who can get through it, they come out the other end and then they build their strength and quality again. But that whole period of growth is very difficult for a gymnast. So technical limits this. Time limits this. Opportunity. So it's not only time in the gym, can I get on the apparatus when I want to get on it? Can I shoot goals at the proper goal thing when I want to? Can I get on proper court time? Can I shoot enough goals that we know we have to? So it's not actually just turning up to training. Are you providing an environment that can facilitate high performance learning? Do you have 30 kids in a training session and you know you've only got one diamond? Can you supply the right environment that diamond gets enough goes? They're the things that will limit your ability to learn all of this. And there's one more big limitation, and that's talent. There is no taking away we're looking for a specific talent. It's like basketball. You can't do it. You can't, if you can't think you're going to be in the NBA and you're 5'5", it doesn't happen. It will never happen. So it's the same for gymnastics. We're looking for a specific build. Gymnasts are in the bottom 30th percentile of a normal population. Child growth, you know, goes like that. We want them to be in the bottom 30th percentile here, or below. Don't pick a kid who's in the 80th percentile. It's not going to happen. They're going to go like that, and they're going to be 5'11". It's human growth is human growth. Sure, timing changes. There's a little bit here, a little bit there. But unless there's a catastrophic problem, a child gets very, very sick or something happens, they're going to grow in a normal, sequential manner. Looking at parents is important to us. Looking at the baseline capabilities of that athlete is a limitation on being able to provide and do the curriculum. I just thought that's very interesting. Right, I'm going to do a demonstration now, and bear with me. I need to get my technology working. Grab a drink if you like, because I'm just whizz up my technology. Project of ours, we have contracted external experts, and my coordinator Alexis has been highly involved in this area. He's my money ball man, he's my stats man, person who's involved, doesn't know gymnastics, but is really good with data and ideas and managing process for monitoring athletes. So, I'll call for a volunteer. Where's my volunteer? He's here. I prepared one earlier for you. Right. So this is the curriculum. So you can see, you're seeing what I've got on my iPad there. This is the coach. I'm in Melbourne. The assessor's in Perth. Okay, so this is the coach in Melbourne. This is the curriculum. They're all the things I've got to teach this kid. Okay? They're all my things. I'm going today to choose the, let's have a cartwheel to the side position.
I might need a double twist and double. Might need it better.
So I'm going to add an attempt. Come on. Right, so I'm going to choose a file. I'm going to take the video. I could have one already created on my iPad. Oh, there you are.
This is more fun though.
Brilliant. When you're ready. I'm going to use that video. Okay, so it's uploaded. It's now in the space up there. Create an attempt. Okay, so you can see cartwheel to step in is processing. It's been sent up to the cloud. Okay, so now I am assessor. I'm Jo Richards, sitting in my office in Perth. And I've got my website open. Okay, Elliot in Melbourne sent me his cartwheel. I'm going to have a look at it. And we can see, I can look at Elliot. Let's see, Elliot. For a sec. Come on. This is the downhill. Believe me, it's there. There you go. He's there. That's just got to do with the download speed. We're doing it rather quickly. As the assessor, I'll go, that was pretty fair, Elliot. Where was he doing it? He was on a standard tumbling strip. So that you can see that that skill has a rating, like a difficulty rating behind it that we just made up through the expert engagement. We think that's a 2 or something. Fair gives you a, like 5 out of 10. He was on the tumbling strip. It wasn't in competition or under pressure. So that doesn't give you as high as that would. I can say, please straighten your legs. Okay, and submit. So now that's going back to the coach, back to their iPad, right now. It's gone. And so I can be here, and if I refresh what we were doing, okay, so let's, nobody get my coordination. Who you got? Get down there. Let's see what we're doing. Okay, if we go up and we refresh this athlete. Okay, go down to the cartwheel. Where is he? Oh, he's red. Oh, where'd it go? If the assessor has done it in a timely manner, they might not. They might take a day or two to do it. But you can say to your athlete, look, Joe's seen the cartwheel. What did Joe think? Let's remember what it looked like. Okay. And we can go view the attempt. We can see our cartwheel again. La, 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 la. There he is doing his cartwheel. We can look at what Joe thought. Joe thought it was a fair, and you want to tell me straight, and you have to straighten your legs, because it's not good enough. And then you can go back and look up what your graph is doing. And he's done that many skills, so his little spider graph is really bad. But I'll show you what it could look like. So we've been doing this manually in WAG for 5 or 6 years. So we've established a lot of data and really clever. I had 2,500 Excel spreadsheets. Our consultants ingested the data off my Excel spreadsheets, and it's all in the program. So all the historical data that I had 1,000,001 spreadsheets on is now inside this lovely framework, and I'll show you how that looks when it loads. So we've got all our 4 gym sports. We're working on WAG at the moment. Athletes, so this is me now as the manager. I've been 3 people today. I've been the coach, I've been the assessor, and now I'm the manager. I'm the pathways manager. These are all my athletes, an athlete demo sitting there. So let's look at a real athlete. So let's look at this little girl. She's outstanding. What does her graph look like? Hello, this is Sydney, and she's been working with us for a number of years. She's 12. So this is Sydney's profile of where her strengths and weaknesses lie. The red Sydney is the best ever score we've had on that apparatus for that age, historical data, until this year. So for Sydney, that's really awesome, because look how much better she is than anyone else we've had on that apparatus ever. She's here. But we've set them a target to be 20% better than anything we've ever seen before. So Sydney is still looking to try and be better here. But what are her other apparatus doing? She's a little weak on these ones, but that girl's a superstar in the making on that one. So it's a really useful tool for both parents, administrators, coaches to have a really good picture of what the athlete in training is looking like. If she flicks down, she can see what ones she's done. So if we look at her basics, she's going super on those easy things. There's video and scores behind all of that. But where is she? What hasn't she learnt yet? And you can see where she's learnt 2 out of 8 in that area. She's learnt 3 out of 6 things in that area. So she's building her skill curriculum every step of the way. I go back and I look at another athlete just to demonstrate difference. So if I look at this little girl, another one of our most outstanding 12-year-olds. So one was training in Perth and one was training in Melbourne. So this little girl's in Melbourne, very different profile. But if you look at Nina, she's really strong on the beam, but she's weak on the trampoline. So when I intervene and have a meeting with those coaches, I've got Nina in front of me and I say, well, super job on the beam, keep going. Now let's look at your individual athlete plan for the trampoline. She's behind, we know that that's going to underpin her other apparatus. What are we going to do to fix that? So trying to be really clear with giving good guidance to these coaches about what's important. What do I do with the information? For all of our girls 14 and under, this is how we pick national training camps. We don't pick off competition data. We only select off training data, which is this data. So if you've worked on your curriculum and you've improved yourself to have this score, I rank all the 12-year-olds. Nina's got 8,779. Where does that put her on the list? I basically take about half the cohort to a camp, and Nina's one of those athletes. And for the 5 or 6 years that I've been doing this, there's a high, high, high relationship. I haven't done the stats, but Alexis will do that shortly. Performance on this test and likelihood to make an Australian team. It is almost 100%. So if your curriculum is strong, you are going to be last man standing because you have the skills to take you to a higher level. Girls who have a little circle like this, so their little red square looks like that, I can be highly clear that it is highly unlikely she will have the skills required to take her to the next step unless something changes. So that's where, again, we make an intervention. We've got to pick up the pace or do whatever's necessary to learn the skills. What are your limiting factors? Is she just not talented enough? Is this environment the wrong environment? I can't get enough training hours with this coach, shift coaches. I can't get enough apparatus time. What are we going to do inside that gym? Is that gym a suitable place for a high performance environment? It just brings questions that we have to the front because it's all about the athlete in the end, actually. Can we produce an athlete of the highest caliber from your environment? So it's very interesting. So this is new technology for us. There's nothing like it in the world. We did a lot of research. And the reason there's nothing like it in the world is the metrics behind it all. So it takes away the I reckon that kid's better than that kid. They play in a better team, it makes that kid look better. No, I don't want to know about what team you're playing. I want to know what you can do. How are you going to be the better athlete? Takes that out of it. So it's very interesting. Let's just go back a step. So this is a really big part of our Team Future program, and we call it the virtual assessment tool. So that circle of information seamlessly, without getting out one Excel spreadsheet, is done. So much more time efficient and a way to manage our decentralized training procedures. Like we've got 16 different Team Future WAD programs around the country. How do we know that you're better than you? Or you're weak on this apparatus, or you're strong on that apparatus? That's how we do it. Next of great importance is physical conditioning and assessment. It underpins our technical development and is of high interest to us in pathways, not necessarily because we want to produce a weightlifting world champion. It's to keep the athlete strong and healthy, robust, to be able to train for a long time and do a high load. That is the reason why physical conditioning is important, is for the health and the well-being over a long period of time of the athlete. So it's really important. We monitor it. We do a lot of running testing, positional testing. We've got spreadsheets going. And this will soon be on our virtual assessment tool. So instead of doing your chin-ups for me, I can video it, put it on there, give it a ranking, and we will have another attribute, which is your physical condition, in our matrix. Not just your technical, but what is your physical doing? We mainly do physical testing when we come into national camp so we can control environment. But if it's on video, we can trust the information that personal coaches are giving us a little bit more. So our camps, we have, we're running about 14 different development camps this year across the board, across our gym sports. So we bring athletes in and out of Canberra all the time. For each gym sport and for each age group, they're twice annually. So they'll come in following their national competition. They'll come in straight after that. We'll regroup, set the goals for the next set of training before then they prepare for their next set of competitions and come back to camp again. Large part of the camps are about coach leadership and development. There's a few non-negotiables about our camp. Athletes must come to camp with their personal coach. They can't come otherwise. Now this is workable for us because gymnastics is highly professional and highly regulated. It fits in the category like swimming and dancing, really. It is, coaches get paid right from the very low level. So it's quite commercial. So when athletes are coming in and out, how does that coach, you know, get time off work and come? In general, it's high priority to that coach, if not their full-time job. Like, for example, even in Perth, there'd be three or four clubs that are million-dollar budgets employing 7 or 8 full-time staff and 40 or 50 part-time staff. That's not exaggerating. That's how big some gymnastics clubs are. And they have over 1,000 members coming and going, similar to a dancing school or the like. So that's how coaches can come to the camps. But if you're in the high-performance pathway, that's expected. Your athletes do not come alone, because what's important is not the 6 days that they're at camp in the year, it's the other 350 that they're alone with you, that you better be doing the right thing. So it's mentoring those coaches. We have a system, what we call master coaches. So our national team coaches, the coaches that we do send overseas, they're expected to come back and give back to Team Future. So they are on the floor mentoring the young coach standing next to them, giving them pointers, instructing their kids, sharing their information that they've gained on GA trips to the World Championships or wherever they've gone. That's part of our culture, is the give back. They get paid to come, yes, they don't do it for free, but their attitude is very much of giving, giving to everybody who's willing to accept it. So that's the national coach there at one of our camps, instructing one of the kids that's training elsewhere. Mentoring from other athletes is really important. We regularly bring in our champions and have them in the gym, either training next to the kids or mentoring them externally. Even assistant coaching. To be assistant coached by Lauren Mitchell is pretty special for young kids. we've just developed a new program for our coaches at this Team Future level called the Coach Immersion Program. And our first thing we'll be doing with them is taking them overseas next March. And there's three aspects that we'd like them to gain. Not only are we going to go and watch a world junior level competition and get behind the scenes, see what the training actually is, but we're going to take them to another high intensity child development type of sport in the States. So something like your Michael Johnson Academy or your Bolitari Tennis Academy or something similar, so that these coaches can see other professionals in another sport doing high level work. Then also going into one of the high level training environments in the States. USA is the number one team in women's gymnastics at the moment, and similarly in the other sports they have very, very competitive. So that's an interesting program. Athlete and coach competencies. We have a matrix. So every time the kids come to camp, we've worked out, well, what are the things that a top level athlete needs to know about to make them ready? So my job is to ready the athletes. So we have a matrix and a rolling 4-year schedule on units such as these. So at ASADA, so drug education, that happens when they come to camp. Video review, every time they come, we get out the latest world championships. We want the kids to be students of the sport, to be absolutely in love with the champions of our sport, to know the history, to know who's the champion right now, what are they doing, really emerging those athletes in our sport. What are the rules of our sport? We talk about athlete journey, so when someone like Olivia Vivian comes to camp, what would I tell my younger self? And for her to give a talk to the athletes about how could I have done my journey better? Well, what do I know now that I wish I'd known when I was your age? We take them to the library and ask them to research gymnastics. We do a social media talk. We talk about mental skills. So not so much psychology these days, but mental skills. We have an honours student working with Team Future at the moment, and she's doing an inventory on what are the critical aspects that a gymnast, developing gymnast, need. And one of them is grit. And that's the ability to not give up, to work really hard for a really long time and not give up. So which kids have grit? Which kids have the ticker that's going to take them to the top? Trying to identify those kids earlier. And if someone doesn't have it, why don't they have it? And could we intervene? Could we help them gain it? It's an interesting question. We create recovery, nutrition, individual athlete planning, all sorts of things are covered when the kids come into camp. And they're tasters that then their personal coaches are expected to extend and develop with their home community. Right, let's get back to it. So this is all within the Team Future umbrella. And it's taking us, I haven't developed this, this is just a model, towards something that's more like this. Quantifying talent in a holistic way. And if you've worked with the AIS, it's a bit like 3DAD of the F10. What are all the attributes every step of the way that if they aren't in place, the athlete's not going to make it? So these sorts of things, as we've spoken about, are all really important because they interplay together to make that critical balance of whether an athlete can flow through the system. If one of these is missing, it's really difficult. I mean, yeah, club and equipment or environment, the coach, are they upskilled enough? Their competition results has a little bit to do with it at the young end. Can they compete without anxiety? Their mental skills, their curriculum, which was this ideal skills that we've spoken a lot about today. And the interplay between those factors is the million-dollar question, and that's where we're headed, is trying to embrace things that happen along the way and work with them, I guess, is how you describe it. Some things we can't change, But it's better to know about it, to support the athlete with that, than to not know about it at all, or expect it just to come naturally. It doesn't come naturally to some people. They need to be taught mental skills, or upskill the coach, etc. So that's where we're headed, but we're not there yet. Finally, I'd like to just spend some time on our second project. So that's we've discussed Team Future, and the second one is Spin to Win, which is a funny little name. And it is a project which is a three-way project between Gymnastics Australia, Diving Australia, and the Winter Institute, aerial skiing. And it is a talent ID and transfer program. And it's unique. We were the first national sporting organisation to win a competitive innovation grant for something as soft as this project. It is not a tangible build. It is a system build for us in relationships. So let's just have a look at what I mean. There's two objectives. Ooh, I'm back. Two objectives to Spin to Win. Now, the term Spin to Win was thought of over a glass of red wine between several CEOs. It wasn't mine, eh? But they thought of it. Spin to Win was catchy, and now that's what it's called. So in essence, it is quantifying something that's happened for a long time, been happening for a long time, and that is this part, talent transfer. This is our ultimate aim, to create gymnastics as a sport, the home sport for acrobatic and small people towards these sports. We know that we may fail in our quest for international glory. We're trying our absolute hardest, but it's a really tough ask to expect gymnasts to be on the podium in Rio or in the near future. Hopefully with our new systems in place, you know, something like the VAT may make all the difference to get coaches to get on the plan and get those athletes moving, but chances are we won't win that medal. Maybe not. So we don't want gymnastics to be dead in the water and for our funding to stop. So we've reinvented ourselves as the feeders to some other sports. And our funding at the moment is for diving and aerial skiing. But of course, as gymnasts flow through our system and our biggest memberships are in WAG and MAG, Men's and Women's Artistic Gymnastics, can anyone who drops out of the system go to trampolining or rhythmic gymnastics? That's our first question. Feed ourselves. Can we shift the talent? Okay, an artistic gymnast gets a sore wrist. Can they go and become a trampolinist? Have they developed enough competencies that they can transfer to another end of the gym sports? Yes, no. Diving and aerial skiing, they both want different beasts. Diving would like someone aged between about 8 and 12 who has the competencies of a gymnast. Aerial skiing wants someone who is over 16 with a robust body with skills of gymnast. So they're two different ports of call. The trade-off for our funding to feed these sports is funding to do this better. We know we need to find more of the kids in F and get the best ones to come to T. So we've employed a coordinator in Pathways, her name's Bree Bryant, to coordinate this program for us in our Pathways team. We also know that there's these sports, and they're just the beginning of a very long list of people knocking on my door who say, I want a piece of the action. And that's all fine and dandy. We can help you out, but there has to be a win for gymnastics. And that's the big question. Okay, we're getting money for this. Where's our money for that? Because we need money for this. And we need to find those kids who are out in club land. As I said, 90% of our members sit over here. What is there to get that kid to go there? Other than a chance event. That the right door opened, your mother took you to the right gym, who was sympathetic to the high performance cause, who called up Waste, who got you in for a trial, da 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 da. It's all chance. We have to take a chance out of it. So we now have five targeted programs in Australia who we're working with to try and improve the opportunity for athletes to come out of the club system and into the high performance system. Oops. Oopsie. Interestingly, we went back in time and looked at the data for, for area 3. And if you think that there's a lot of gymnasts involved, there certainly is. So everything green there means they're an ex-gymnast. So this was your 2014 aerial skiing team, 2010 and beyond. I'd say 90% of the team were gymnasts and went on to win medals. So whose medal is it? That's the question. If they did 7 or 8 years in gymnastics and then 4 years in aerial skiing and won the medal, whose athlete is it? So that's where we're trying to pitch ourselves. And similarly for diving, the green ones are the gymnasts. So from their fantastic medals, and we all know diving's doing wonderfully well and we love that, very proud of diving, where did they come from? Where was their home? Who taught them their acrobatics to start with before they became that wonderful diver? All the green ones were gymnasts. So the evidence is absolutely concrete, and I think if you even went to other sports like your pole vaults, etc., it's unrefutable that gymnastics needs to, in order to keep providing that talent through, we need to have a strong system ourselves. We even went and talked to a lot of divers before we started this project. And that's what the pool looks like. Blue is with a gymnastics background, and orange is without a gymnastics background. For the current divers in the TID system right now, that's how many of them have gymnastics experience. So, why change? This is why change. They're only 60% full. So when we looked at diving and aerial skiing, only for their TID system was only 60% capacity. They had another 40% of open spaces. They can't attract the kids to come to the sport because they're not the ones in the sport. So we've turned it on its head and actively promoting transitional gymnasts to take a look at the other options. And of course, quality of those 60%. Have they found the best possible candidates? So through our VAT, I'll be able to categorically target kids who have really good trampolining skills. When this kid retires, they should go to diving because they have the skill set that diving are looking for, or the skill set that aerial skiing are looking for. We can be far more targeted and almost flagging kids in our system that they could be going in that direction when it's time to finish with gymnastics. Both sports are lacking in boys. Heavily female driven with not many boys. And we have the boys in our sport. So it's a little bit of education and communication to try and assist those boys to move over. That's a diving session, by the way. Doesn't look like diving. Right. That basically tells you what we just spoke about. It's transitional athletes. So knowing our community, being able to tap kids on the shoulder when they're on the way out, and opening up a suite of experiences that they could step into. I think it's really positive and a really healthy way to look at sport is that your journey doesn't end once this sport finishes. You've learned all of these competencies. You're a valuable sporting asset. That's the message to tell a retiring gymnast. You have so many skills that so many other people want. Step through another door and see where it takes you. We also get a bad rap for kids retiring so young or so early. If we look at it, that's just the beginning of their sporting career. They can have a second career beyond gymnastics. Not many sports can say that our retiring athletes could go into an under 55 kilo weight category. We're probably the only sport that has retiring athletes that are that small. because they've been attracted and fostered because of their small stature to start with. So to a sport like weightlifting, etc., that is really alluring to think that, that there's a pool of kids who are the right size with the right training attitude, have been through a high performance system, they know hard work, and then to move on to weightlifting or such is not such a stretch. Same with the combat sports, although in gymnastics we don't like touching each other. It's a very, you know, personal space kind of sport, so I don't know how they'll go with the whole judo thing, but body size and acrobatically, physically, very similar. So the other end, which is our TID end, so that's the transfer end, and the payoff for us is the TID end. Bree's also working really hard in that area. And providing clear protocols. What are we really looking for throughout our community? And really bridging high performance back to our community. Not putting ourselves in a little cocoon and waiting for people to come through our door. Getting into their community and selling ourselves a lot better. She is awesome physical ability. How big do you think she is? Strong, she's built, hey. You look at her and you think, athlete. She's 145 centimetres tall. I'm 165 and I've got heels on today. She'd be that big. World champion. That is what we're up against, and that's what we've got to find. They're a unique little beast. We didn't make them like that. They walked in the gym like that. She walked in as a six-year-old who was heavy set, bouncing off the walls, let me at it. That's what we're looking for, and it's trying to get that message down to the club land that they may only, if they're a pathways club, may only give up one athlete a year to a high performance training regime. But that's the athlete I want. Someone who can jump like that, look like that, grow that big, and that's worth the investment. So it's getting that message back down to the clubs is really tricky, but we're working on it really hard. We're doing all sorts of things. So the funding's come back through that loop, scouting competitions, looking at kinder gym programs, talent ID days, general call-ins. I think it's 80% of Gymnastics Australia clubs have a waiting list, and some are up to 1,000 kids sitting on a waiting list. What if my diamond is on the waiting list? I need to be able to vet a waiting list and see if there's something in there that interests me and get her up the list and into the gym. Because some kids will sit on a waiting list forever. They'll never get to do gymnastics. That's how popular it is. You know the latest school sport thing? You know, the after school sports? Gymnastics is the highest signed up sport for that program. And that's got not much to do with me because it's more on the general gym end. But it's the highest demand sport out of any sport, and we can't, it's something like those, if we counted up the numbers, 60,000 kids to service across our sporting network. We don't know how we're going to do it, and the foundation team are madly upskilling the club coaches to supply the coaches who can do that. A lot of interest in gymnastics, and we can't keep up with the demand. 6-6 concept, so trying to get clubs to come in with their best 6-6-year-olds and train externally to their normal training in a high-performance environment as a taster. For 6 weeks, 6 clubs come in with 6 kids who are 6 years old, and we upskill that coach so the coach can get some professional development, and then we might take one of those to come into the proper squads. That type of upskilling. Working hard on promotional materials. In the long term, I see TID being useful out of our new VAT system. So that online tool, so a suite of, say, 5 physical tests for a 5-year-old, 6-year-old, that club coach puts them through those tests and sends it in through the VAT so that someone of knowledge can look at that kid and say, yeah, that kid's a diamond, bring them in and we want to have another look. So getting people out in the community actually doing the work for us more is where we're headed, because we are time poor and resource poor. And I think that's where we'll leave it today. There was a whole heap of information that I hope has given you some, you go away thinking, oh, I like that idea, I might try that in this circumstance. Because I know my sport is different to your sport. Every sport is different. But the theory behind what we're doing, I think, is the same throughout. So if anybody has any questions, I'd like to open it up now to any questions about anything. Yeah?
Just the lifestyle one, very early you talked about the parents and the involvement, particular to your sport where you've got young girls or young athletes and they're spending so much invested time early before school and then after school. How do you reward or champion or upskill parents in terms of riding that length of period out from 6 to, as you say, 16?
That's a good question. And I think a lot of it comes with communication, role modelling. It's definitely more easier and functionally better in high performance environments that have a long history. It's exceptionally difficult for clubs or programs who are just beginning this journey and they don't have the role modelling in the program to start with. So parents are flying blind. So that's where I guess Gymnastics Australia steps in and partners them up with other programs who are doing something similar so that they have the chance to see this is not so weird. There's other people in another city doing exactly what you're doing. And that's, I guess, becoming a community like the Team Future is, there's far more swapping of information than there ever has been. Nothing's a secret anymore. Everything's on the internet anyway. We may as well just share the knowledge. But it is an issue. And as I said, harder for the clubs that it's their first time. Yeah.
We've got a way of measuring the grit.
There's a grit scale. There is such a thing.
I knew there would be.
There's a grid scale. And we've just put our 240 Team Future athletes across the 4 gym sports in their last camp. We've put them through it. And that's what our honours student has worked on. So we'll get that back shortly and then we'll progress forward from there. So there are inventories.
So what sort of things are on the grid?
Your tenacity, your ability to stay to task. Am I the sort of person who gets easily put off task? Do I keep a training diary? Do I analyse my performance as I'm driving home in the car? They're sorts of things that are traits of a highly gritty person. Do I give up easily, I guess? Am I easily pulled off task?
Who makes the final decision on some of the coaches? So an athlete goes to a coach, who makes the decision that coach is not working and
That's really tricky. At the higher level where Liz works at, so the higher senior athletes, the person like in Liz's position, women's national program manager, can give them a tap on the shoulder and say, actually, you'd be better off there. And then it's up to the parent and the athlete to decide. If they've been told, we think your chances are better if you go to that environment, and they still don't change, that's their choice. But at that younger Team Future area, we're kind of not tackling it like that. We're trying to help the situation rather than remove the athlete. But they've only got until she's probably 14. And then after that, they'll be tapped on the shoulder to shift. But we do have kids in the system currently who aren't training where we think is in their best interest. But it's Australia.
Mm-hmm. Joe, on the, I suppose, I don't know if I've heard it correct or not, but can you tell us, do you use the FTEP model to rank your clubs specifically, as in who's providing the a talent club specifically, or a T2 club, because they knew they're in F1 or F2 club? Or
look, we haven't as yet, but that's not a big stretch. I think it could be, because in my mind, I've ranked them. I know who's providing a T1 experience, a T2, who can only go as far as T2, and then those athletes will either fall back to F3 or they'll move on to T3 in another location. I know that who they are, but I haven't been as out there to actually put it on our website or anything like that yet.
Do you have anything that kind of guides clubs into where they should be in that specific?
Yeah, we have a Club 10, which is a good practice framework. And it's always been my ambition to, within that good practice framework, have a high performance module so that clubs know you have to be able to offer this much training in this environment at that time to call yourself high performance. Because nothing grates on you more than clubs calling themselves high performance and offering. And it's like, it's just, for people who don't know any better, it's very frustrating. So that's definitely an area that needs work. And if you've got a framework of club management already, it needs to fit nicely inside that.
Yeah. How's the, I guess, the virtual assessment, or what's the buy-in like in the general community, and what's the take-up rate?
Yeah, well, we've only just started it, and it's been great. Yeah. Really, really good. And I think the critical part is that we're using their currency. They want their kids to be chosen for national training camps. And if you're not on it, you can't be chosen. If you're not playing the game and jumping through the hoops, you won't get to where they want. So that's their currency, is a position on a national training camp. Everyone wants one. It's like a golden ticket that they get invited to come and train and all this whiz-bang stuff that they are, yes, with the community or with the national coaches. Everyone wants a ticket. The only way to get the ticket is through stuff. So it kind of sells itself. But they're probably about 10%, that's exaggerating, of coaches out there who think they know better. They're basically the unconvertibles. And generally they're older international sort of coaches, come from another country, know the system, they know best. At the end of the day, they still want their kid to come to training camp. So they do the bare minimum to get by, to get into training camp, and yeah, I can live with that. They're probably the ones I'm not trying to help. I'm trying to help the young Australian coach to learn better technique and support their athlete better. And they're certainly on board. They love it. Yeah.
One question, so you know how you said there's like different age groups in terms of, you know, like so for women's artistic gymnastics, like they would normally finish around 16, or that's where you're looking to get them. So like the Team Future model goes up to 14 mm-hmm. years old. But so for trampoline and for men's artistic, like where the, you know, it extends a little bit later, why wouldn't you then make the Team Future sort of like extend maybe a little bit later?
Yeah, there's a possibility of doing that as we get to know our cohort better. Yeah. I think there's a step between Team Future that fits in that T4 area.
Yeah.
Before junior and senior. In women's gymnastics, we do it quite well. We have a four-tiered national training camp sort of set, whereas in some of the other more immature gym sports, we only have Team Future and then we have the end. We don't have the stepping stones in between, and they need to be put in the near future. Mm. Yeah, all right.
On 3D AD and obviously the different developmental needs at different points in the pathway, are you guys aligning, or have you aligned your coach development curriculum to meet sort of the needs of the athlete development pathway? You know, sort of,
yes.
I guess the concept being what makes a great high performance coach might not be what you need at T1 specifically, might be different skill set.
Yeah, look, I think we have, but it's only been recently. Prior to probably 2 or 3 years ago, education was over there and coaching and actual training was over here. And they really didn't have a lot of interplay between them. And I guess now with Pathways, it's almost brought it both together. So I'm quite often speaking with our education team and my coaching team and trying to put them together. So that trip I was talking about next year is run by the education people. So it's targeted Team Future coaches to educate them and put them in a practical application of their skill. All the coaching courses have been rewritten in the last 2 years and they've used our ideal skills as the template of what skills should be taught for them to teach the right thing. So it's all integrated now, but it's only been very recent. It's such a big job, huge job, to get all that to talk together. But I think at Gymnastics Australia, we have 4 functional areas, like finance and office, high performance, general gymnastics and education. And I think they're much better since AWE came in, I don't know why that would have changed things, but in the last 2 years, things are functioning much better and relying on each other. Like, I know those F people better do their job because I need that talent to put in my high performance. So we're working together better.